appearance, Mom. Oh, gold! It was due back at the library yesterday. Well, bad enough, not knowing where the book is. Oh, and not knowing the identity of the killer. I mean, without being fined 10 cents a day besides.
Yes, but the library wasn't open yesterday, Mom.
It wasn't? Well, why not?
Well, it's never open on Sunday.
Sunday? Well, yesterday was Sunday, but that would mean...
Well, mean what, Mom?
Bianca, it would mean today's Monday, and it can't be.
Well, I don't see why not, Mom. Monday has a way of following Sunday.
Bianca, if it were Monday, well, I mean, firstly, the damn book would already be 2 days late. Well, and frankly, I'm not that slow a reader. Well, and then secondly, if it were Monday, Mr. Gilmore would be at work. Well, I've tried him there twice today, and he's not.
Well, perhaps he stepped out, Mom.
Oh, no, no. Mr. Gilmore is a very busy broker. Mondays are his busy days. I mean, no one on Wall Street ever steps out on a Monday.
Well, nevertheless, Mom.
Bianca, have it your way. Today's Monday. Now, I don't suppose you've seen the creeping slasher lying about.
Oh, no, Mom. Where did you see it last?
Oh, right here. I always read right here in this chair. I mean, October tends to be chilly. It's cozier that way before the fire.
Oh, well, now that you mention it, Mom, it is rather chilly. I'll just start a fire.
Oh, for all the good it will do.
Mom?
Well, I mean, what is the sense of having a cozy chair before the fire and no creeping slasher?
Oh, nevertheless, Mom, if you should find your book, you'll have a nice warm spot in front of the fire to read it.
Oh, Bianca, oh, you are a treasure.
But if I might ask, Mom, yes, why do you always hide your mystery thrillers?
I don't think I follow you, Bianca.
Well, I mean, you do read everything by Anton Dupree. I'm surprised you don't have them all nicely lined up on a shelf in your bedroom.
Well, I mean, how could I? Well, think of all those library finds.
I mean, buy them, Mom. If you enjoy them so much, I should think you'd want to own them.
Oh, I would. I mean, I truly would. But if I own them all, I'd soon run out of hiding places. There are only so many seat cushions and drawers, you know.
Well, yes, but why hide them in the first place?
Oh, I understand. Well, you see, Mr. Gilmore does not approve of my mystery thrillers. He says they rot one's mind. Well, he thinks everyone should read the classics, like War and Peace. I know I tried that once. Everyone's name was Ivan Ivanovich or some sort of thing. I mean, I couldn't keep the characters straight. I tell you, that's a book that would rot one's mind.
Oh, I see. Well, yes, I quite understand, but Mom, if you must hide your books, why not keep them in one special spot? You know, someplace they'll always be whenever you're looking for them.
You know, I would, but I'm never quite sure where I'll be when Tobias pops up. I mean, I have to be able to stick the book in the quickest possible place that's handy.
Well, just think. Where were you the last time you read The Creeping Slasher? And Mr. Gilmore popped up and had to stash it real quick.
You know, I'm not sure. Tobias tends to pop up all over his apartment. I mean, not that he shouldn't. It's his home, after all. You know, it reminds me, it's almost 6 o'clock. Shouldn't he be home by now?
Oh. Well, now that you mention it, he is a bit later than usual. Perhaps he stepped out to buy you a birthday present.
A what? A birthday present? Oh, Bianca, it can't be that time of year again already. I can't be another year older, can I?
Your birthday isn't until tomorrow.
Well, that's a mercy.
And if I might ask, how ever do you do it, Mom? I mean, you don't look your age at all.
Bianca, that's work. Very hard work. I mean, I get plenty of exercise, and I watch my diet. Well, I avoid late nights whenever possible. I own a dozen in her beauty rest, you know. My beauty rest, that's it, Bianca. My focus underneath my mattress. Oh, thank you, Bianca.
What?
Bianca, be a dear, please, and get my coat. I must get this back to the library today.
Well, aren't you going to finish it, Mom?
Oh, there's plenty of time for that on the bus. I mean, I do only have two chapters left.
The bus? You mean you're not going to take your car?
Oh, no, no. I tried that once. I mean, the only time I had to read was at the light. Well, I get engrossed in the plot. And, well, dreadful people would start honking their horns. Well, I had to go to the next light and try to find my place again. And oh, it was just such
very light.
Our treasure.
Oh, Mrs. Gilmore.
Yes.
What should I tell Mr. Gilmore?
About what?
Well, if he should come home and wonder where you went.
Oh, well, tell him I went out for a stroll.
In October?
Oh, why not? I mean, it is October. Isn't it?
Thank you. Thank you, Mama.
Thank you.
This is delicious.
Oh, yes, I know. Oh, I mean, that's what Mr. Gilmore says, so they must be.
Huh, good evening, Bianca. Hershey, what are you doing here?
Shouldn't she be, sir?
Oh, what? Yes, of course. I just didn't expect her. A business acquaintance. I'm usual to see her after business hours. Is Gilmore in?
Oh, no, sir. She went to take a stroll.
Oh, good.
Why?
She needs exercise.
You can't get enough exercise. Speeds up the skin, firms the blood.
Or is it the other way around?
Bianca?
Yes, sir.
Don't you have something to do in the kitchen?
Such as?
Fixing dinner.
Oh, it's all fixed, sir.
Cleaning the pots, then.
Well, they're all clean and put away.
Scrubbing the floors?
All scrubbed.
The counters?
Them too.
The ceiling? Never mind my maid. What are you doing here?
Well, I wanted to see the decor of the place. I mean, after all, if I'm to do the upholstery and the seaplane, I want to choose something suitable to your wife's needs.
Keep your voice down, Bianca. You're in a beagle.
But why shouldn't she hear?
The airplane's a surprise for my wife's birthday tomorrow. If she hears and mentions it, the whole thing will be...
Oh, so that's what all the secrecy is about. You should have told me it was a surprise. Why are you so nervous about whether your wife was here?
I didn't tell you it was a surprise because I never even expected you to meet my wife. But it is, and you mustn't. So you saw the decor down here. Please, please, kindly get out of here.
But I haven't seen your measure.
So?
Well, a woman's most personal taste goes into the decor of her bedroom. Well, that would give me a clue on the evening.
Very well, very well. It's right over here. Make it fast, or Marsha may be home any moment.
Big, dark glasses with jewels on them.
like the spines reading was now in a long black trench coat and a big
I don't know such acquaintance. I mean, I do suppose that Tobias has hundreds of clients of what I'm not aware of, but a smasher, you say?
Very much so, Mom.
Oh, but of course, nothing compared to you, Mom.
Well, that's a mercy. Now, back to the slashing.
And I'll get back on that ceiling.
The ceiling?
Well, I hope you're satisfied, Marsha.
Eminently. That bedroom is absolutely beautiful.
Say your praises for later. When Marsha would have came in here and caught us, oh my God.
You worry too much. I'm sure she'll never suspect a thing.
I certainly hope you're right. I mean, the whole point of our plan is to take her completely by surprise.
I'm sure we'll be able to pull it off without a hitch. After all, she has no reason to distrust you tomorrow when we suggest a drive down to the bay.
I can hardly wait to see our face when we get there. You know, you and I, standing there, well, you know, I'll take up that champagne bottle and I'll break it over her nose, and you and I will watch as she slides slowly into the water.
Well, it seems such a waste of good champagne.
Yeah, such a good cause. Besides, there'll be plenty of champagne later at the party.
I hope you'll let me propose a toast. Your wife has such marvelous taste. In bedroom decor and in husband.
I suppose it won't be easy when I get her down there by the bay. I mean, it'd be a shame, really. She'd probably be here only in spirit. You and I, sitting here drinking champagne while she's floating up there in the heavens.
Well, I really should insist you bring her back here afterward.
I'll try, but I suppose it won't be easy. I mean, after I get her down by the bay, I may well have to drag her back to the spot.
Well, que sera, sera.
Bianca! Bianca!
Oh, Mr. Gilmore! Well, I didn't hear you come back, sir.
Back from where? I haven't been out.
Oh, well, a moment ago, but I came in here, and I didn't see you or that divorce woman, sir.
We were planning a surprise in the bedroom for Miss... my wife.
Kind of surprise, sir.
Never you mind. Listen. You must not tell Marsha under any circumstances about this, about her visit today, Mr. Moore's visit.
Oh, well, I won't tell her.
Good.
You don't want me to.
Good. I knew I could count on your discretion.
Oh, always, sir.
Good, good. Bianca, where's my martini?
Oh, that's a poor lady. Drink it, sir. Let me make you a new one, sir. Something to shake us all deluded by now.
Oh, wait. Matter of fact, I think I'll take a shower before dinner. Have a waiting when I come out, huh?
Very well, sir. Bianca! What am I going to do? About what? My husband, Tobias! And that DeVore woman! They're planning on murdering me!
Oh, come now, Mom. Surely you've made some sort of mistake.
No! I mean, I heard them!
They're planning on luring me down to the bay. Champagne bottle and watching me float into the water.
Well, then I'm going to come back here to celebrate.
Surely you've been reading too many mystery novels, Mom.
No. It's just like the creepy slash. With one fortunate difference. I put out for their sword scheme.
Mom, if you're so certain, why not just stay away from the bay for a while?
No, no. That would only delay your plan. And another time, and another way. Well, the next time I may not be so fortunate to find out. What is this stuff?
What's a martini, Mom?
Oh, no wonder. I hate martinis.
Well, can I make you something different then?
Oh, no, no. I wouldn't be able to enjoy it anyway. I mean, oh,
run off with another woman.
Well, I would call the domestics union, Mom. They're very strict against things like that.
No, no, if you were his wife.
Oh. Well, I suppose. I'd call the police. They don't like it when people bop each other on the head and let them fall into the drink.
The police? Oh, that's it. Oh, thank you, dear. You are a treasure. Oh, damn.
Mom?
Oh, I've gotten one of those recordings that says not to bother the operator unless it's an emergency. Like, what would she have to do other than to answer my call? Oh, hello, operator. Yes, I'd like to speak to a policeman, please. Well, no, I don't know which one. Anyone will do. Well, yes, this is an emergency. Oh. No, I will not cross my heart and hope to die. I need to speak to a policeman now. My husband is planning on murdering me. Well, why? I don't know why. I suppose he's grown tired of me. Well, operator, really, I don't think there's time for a marriage counselor. No, I would like to speak to the police. Well, no, I don't want the number. I want the police. Yes, I'm writing it down for future reference. Oh, thank you. Hello, police? Yes, my husband is planning on murdering me. Could you come over right away? Oh, my name? Oh, dear, is that really necessary? I mean, you know, scandal and all? Well, all right, if you must. My name is Marsha Gilmore. And my husband's name is Tobias. Tobias. T-O-B-I-A-S. Well, no, it's not murdering me right now. No, tomorrow, down by the bed. Oh, witnesses? Well, no witnesses, I guess, unless you count that woman he's in cahoots with, but I do doubt she'd be willing to testify. Well, no, look, all I know is that he's planning on luring me down to the bay. He's going to bop me over the head with a champagne bottle, and, well, he's going to watch my body float to the water, and then he's going to come back to my apartment to a party. No, I have not been drinking. Well, maybe just a little one, but damn it, wouldn't you have a drink if you were about to be murdered? Well, because I heard the plan before I had the drink. No one will let cross my heart enough to die. So much for the police. And you'll try my ideas.
How about a martini?
Oh, why not?
Like
them. Oh, I used to think a lot of things beyond them. I used to think my husband loved me. I used to think that operators would answer your phone calls. Well, and I particularly used to think that the police would come when you called them. I was right about these martinis.
You know what you need, Mom?
What?
You need an ally.
An ally? You mean like England or France?
No. I mean someone you can trust. Someone who will help you to save yourself from doom. Even when the police fail you. Do you know, it is done in all the best mystery novels.
Yes, it is. But usually by someone who's in love with the heroine. That way, when
sound out, hold off to the chair.
Well, they get together later.
I don't know anyone like that.
Well,
how about
Mr. Baxter across the hall?
Virgil? Virgil's not in love with me.
Is he?
Oh, well, maybe not yet, Mom. Well, that usually happens halfway through the book.
Well, I suppose, but even if Virgil were to help me, and, well, even if he were to fall in love with me while helping, I mean, I'm not in love with Virgil.
Well, yeah, but you could tell him you were in love with him.
Well, that hardly seems fair to a man.
But getting bopped on the head and dropped in the drink seems fair to you.
Still, it seems so cruel.
And getting murdered doesn't seem cruel?
Well, if you put it that way, Virgil it is. You don't happen to know his number, do you?
Oh, actually, I do, Mom. It's the same as ours.
Well, except the last two numbers, they're reversed.
We get ever so many phone calls from people calling here looking for him. It's such a problem.
Oh, do you suppose he just calls ever meant for us?
Well, I don't see why not, Mom. I mean, fair is fair.
Hello, Virgil. Hi, this is Marsha Gilmore. Oh, fine. Well, no, not actually fine. I mean, emotionally, that is. Well, no, I'm not ill. Oh, well, the truth of the matter is, Virgil, something dreadful has happened. If I just, never mind. Darling, did you have a pleasant shower?
You know, nicer than normal, but pleasant enough, I suppose.
Oh.
Who's out on the phone here?
No one.
But you...
Well, I mean, no one we know. Was the wrong number. Total mistake.
But why did you say never mind? Never mind what?
Oh, she just meant... Never mind the inconvenience he caused her, sir.
Marsha, is there anything wrong?
Well, no, darling, why would you ask that?
You seem sort of tense or something. Marsha, you haven't been reading those Blood and Thunder stories again, I hope.
Nonsense!
You know how we were saying, Major. Dear, they're nothing but trash. It rots the mind, you know.
Oh, I do, darling, I do. And I mean, well, and that's why I don't read them anymore. And frankly, that's why I'm not nervous anymore. Calm, serene, you know, in total control.
Marsha, it's someone the doorbell.
Doorbell? I didn't hear a doorbell. That hurts.
Marsha!
And I didn't scream. That was therapy. I mean, front scream therapy. Oh, it's oh so good for the nerves.
Oh, that was an earshot. Well.
Oh, you mean the knock?
Don't be so technical. Just answer when somebody's at the door. Now come here, you don't have to break it down.
Tell me,
sir. Please, sir, you've come home a long day. Let me get that for you.
I heard it from three!
Well, who did it?
Bianca, is that any way to treat a neighbor?
Darling.
Well, if that's the case, thought you spoke on the phone with me only yesterday.
Well,
but so much has happened since then.
Such as?
That's what we're going to chat about at dinner.
Very well. I'm going to get Bianca off that ceiling.
Whatever happens, act natural. Darling, you came so soon.
Dear, it's only 8 feet down the hall.
But you got there and got back so quickly.
Marsha, it's not like there was any hope on or anything.
Marsha, what is going on?
I can't tell you while Tobias is in the room.
Well, why not?
Mrs. Gilmore is madly in love with you.
What was that she said?
Oh, I said, sir, Mrs. Gilmore is madly in love with you.
Oh, and I am, darling. Oh, I am.
Why would Bianca have to tell us?
Well, it's hardly a secret, Tobias.
Why don't you take Virgil to the dining room and show where he'll receive you for dinner, huh?
But darling, we're not eating until 8 o'clock.
Better late than never, or something.
Shall we?
Persons, are you insane coming back here? I'm quite sure you're
not. Oh, don't worry, I figured out a cover story. Just tell her I'm an interior decorator. Come to me to the apartment.
Persons, you are an interior decorator.
Well, that's what's so perfect for that. I can show her credentials and everything. Well, she'll never guess the real reason I'm here.
And what is the real reason you're here, come to think of it? Hey, we better get our story straight. If she finds out that we have a short for tomorrow.
She won't if we're careful. I want to knock her dead tomorrow just as much as you do.
Shh. She's right in the next room.
You're right. Let's get matters settled before she returns. Here's what I came back to show you. How would this look stitched to the back of her seat?
Would that hold her if she squirmed a lot?
Perhaps not. Tell you what, I can attach it with a lot of upholstery nails.
Oh, yes, that's great. No matter how much she'll never get loose, no matter how much she's thrashed about.
And this, I thought, would be dramatic cemented over her head.
Cemented?
Well, ordinary glue wouldn't hold it in place. The bay's very damp.
All right, do what you want. But once Marsha's in it, I don't want to hear her complaining.
That reminds me. How do you like this material for the straps? Go on, give it a tug.
Oh, yes, that's an over security.
Well, I should hope so. I mean, once she's bobbing in the bay, we don't want her popping out of the thing without warning.
Oh, that's for sure. Hey, now put those things away before she comes back. Seize them, huh?
By the way, you'd better figure out an excuse to lure her down there tomorrow.
I already have, Fred.
Well, I was only trying to
help. Marsha, I'm not trying to call you names. I'm speaking to the sea creature. Marsha adores Fred. I'll just tell her there's a new restaurant down by the sea, and I'm going to take her there for lunch for her birthday, you see.
It sounds like a foolproof scheme. You drive her down to the pier.
We walk slowly down to the end of it.
And then she glances idly down toward the water.
I take out the champagne bottle and...
crash!
Splash!
And go for the bath. Oh, excuse me, Mr. Gilmore. What will Mr. Boyd be saying for dinner?
Have you had dinner?
Well, like a matter of fact,
then it's all set up. She will be staying.
Very well, sir.
Well, should we join others for dinner?
All right, let's. Well, we're back!
This is my wife, Marsha, and our neighbor, Virgil Baxter.
What a pleasure to meet you, Mr. Orr. Whoever you are.
Please, don't be so formal. I mean, pull their purses. Or something.
Well, have we met before?
Well, no, but...
But everyone knows the famous interior decorator.
Yes, of course. Hear your name all the time. You must be quite a marvel.
But how did you recognize your face?
Your turn.
Who saw it in the paper?
Really? I didn't see the paper.
Well, neither did I.
Well, you've both been so busy.
Advising clients.
Decorating interiors.
Well, that's for sure, I dare say.
Well, I'd love to see my picture. You still have the paper.
Do we?
No.
No?
Oh, what a shame. Listen, why don't we all have a drink before dinner, huh?
Well, that sounds like a lovely idea. What would you? do like Virgil.
Something strong.
I know what you mean. Mr. Baxter, what is your line of work?
I'm a pharmacist. And please, call me Virgil.
Well, I wouldn't think pharmacists would be much interested in interior decorating.
Well, not professionally, of course. But it's just that your picture, it was so striking. In the paper, when I saw it, in the paper.
Well, I'd certainly like to see a copy. What exactly was it?
The Saturday
old days?
It was a two-part story. Well, how delightful. In which paper?
The News!
Both papers?
Well, it wasn't an exclusive interview.
Interview? I didn't do any interviews last week. Are you sure?
Of course you're sure.
Say, maybe you had given the interview earlier.
Well, then they ran the story later. Spill it all. Thank you, Tobias. It all sounds rather odd.
A lot of the news has been odd lately.
Yeah. Well, darling, why don't you take Persis and show her where she'll be seated at dinner?
Well, why can't that wait till later, Rita?
Well, you made me do it with Virgil.
Oh, yes, that's right, I did. Okay, would you like to come in?
Oh, well, I suppose we better. If they had to do it.
It's not far, so back down the hall.
Okay, I'll be back in a moment. No hurry. Now do you see why I called you? They're planning on murdering me.
Marsha, you've got to call the police.
Oh, I tried that. They wouldn't come.
Well, you've got to do something.
No, they would kill me sooner.
You could move out of the apartment.
Well, what excuse could I make?
Say you've got an aunt in San Francisco.
San Francisco? Well, that's rather far to go, don't you think?
Well, you wouldn't have to actually go there. You would just leave the apartment and, then you would just come over to my place.
How dare you!
I thought you were in love with me.
Oh, well, I am. Terribly. But all I meant was, wouldn't people think bad things?
Well, that doesn't matter now, does it?
Well, I guess, but still and all, it would only delay matters. Really, what we need is a way to stop them. Finally, forever.
Well, the only way to do that would be to murder them first.
Virgil, that's it! Oh, how shall we do it?
We?
Well, you wouldn't let me face them alone now, would you?
Well, when you put it that way.
Good. Now, do you know there's
but there's no way to know who would be the better fighter. I don't relish a struggle. We've got to be smart about this.
Well, and quick too. I've only got until tomorrow.
Do you have a gun?
No. Do you?
No! I hate guns.
So do I, but even if I didn't, I really don't think I'd have the nerve to just haul off and shoot someone.
Yes, and it could get a little sticky once the police came by.
Oh, but we could tell them that they were planning on murdering me.
But how could you prove it?
Well, I heard them. Well, and you heard them too.
Marsha, when the police arrive and find a dead husband on the floor, they hardly take the word of the wife and the lover about how he died.
You're not my lover.
Tell the police that.
Well, suppose what we need is a way to murder them that will leave no traces.
such a thing.
Well, you're a chemist. I mean, don't you have any chemicals that you can mix together, you know, to make it look like a natural bed?
Well, now that you mention it, that is the first thing they teach you in pharmaceutical college.
It is? Well, good heavens, Virgil, why?
Well, they don't want us accidentally making lethal combinations before we get work.
Oh, that makes sense. Well, maybe we have some in my kitchen.
You know, you're probably right. The average home usually does.
Average? I mean, Virgil, this is hardly an average home. I mean, Tobias is for millions. I mean...
Oh, well, yes, of course. I mean, the average millionaire's home usually does.
Quick, now's your chance.
Oh, Marsha!
No! No! Go in and inspect my pantry.
Inspect your pantry?
For would-be poison.
Oh, yes, yes. Of course. I'll be right back.
Getting cold, kind of like the Eye of the Sphinx is behind the Emerald Mirror. Something like that.
Marsha, there's a big difference between Emerald Mirrors and cold soup.
The thought of Virgil doesn't get out much.
No. Oh, no.
Are you going to change? You can't sit down at the table.
Oh, my God. Listen, whatever you're thinking, I'll be right back in a moment.
But honestly, Tobias, I don't mind.
Well, I do hope my staying for dinner isn't causing too much trouble.
Do you plan on taking 7?
Oh, well, no, I seldom do. By the way, may I use your bathroom? I'd like to freshen up before we go.
Oh, surely. Down the hall, across from our bedroom. But then again, you wouldn't know where our bedroom is now, would you?
Oh, no, of course not. I mean, well, how would I?
Oh, how indeed. Down the hall to your right.
You know, right here, Tobias loves you very much. I mean, you're all he talks about every time I see him. I've never seen a man so completely infatuated with his own wife.
Well, how nice of you to tell me, Miss Tour.
Thank you. Purses, please.
Oh, dear. Oh, I hope we're not acting too hastily. Oh, I need to call Virgil. We've got to put our plan on hold, at least until we're a bit more sure. Hello, Virgil. It's Marsha. Now, about the poison. Well, no, I'm not losing my nerve. It's just that... Yes, I know it's odorless and tasteless and totally undetectable in a postmortem. But, well, is it very painful? Mortal agony? Oh, dear Virgil, no. I mean, even if it is tasteless, odorless, and totally undetectable, I mean, if it's going to cause my darling husband mortal agony, I mean... 3 out of 4 isn't bad.
Marsha unexpectedly, so I had to ask a person to stay for dinner, whether she likes it or not.
Was that a crack?
Whether she likes staying, not whether she likes dinner.
Well, is Bianca still here?
I don't have enough nerve to fire her.
Oh, don't be silly, Toby. I only meant, isn't this usually her night off?
Yes, it is, but she'll leave as soon as she serves dinner.
And it better be soon.
Well, I suppose you'll be dining with us too, Mrs. Barton.
Oh, it's not too much trouble.
Do you really mean that?
Of course she doesn't. Now, will you please set another place for her?
The soup is going to be like ice.
Bianca, could you do me a favor, please?
Tobias, if Levin always comes here on Marsha's birthday, why is she a day early?
She's a problem with calendars. It's like, what's one day here or there, one way or another, that's her motto. But we think she, of all people, would remember the exact date.
Of all people?
Oh, damn, I forgot. That's, well, that is Marsha's mother. I forgot you didn't know.
Well, her forgetfulness must be contagious.
Now, Persis, I don't have forgetful.
Well, then why aren't you on the phone with that airplane?
He got it right out of my head. I don't know what it is about tonight. Everything seems sort of frantic and topsy-turvy. I can't just put my finger on what I mean. The whole thing is kind of clumsy.
I know exactly what you mean, and I can't put my finger on it either. A kind of ominous crackling in the atmosphere, especially when Marsha's in the room.
You don't think she suspects you? I mean, it would spoil the whole plan.
It would ruin everything.
If you don't get over there for your part by tomorrow morning, the whole thing's a bust. I want Marsha to blow away from that pier in style. Damn, the line's busy. Let's try it later. Marsha!
Oh, well, how long have you been standing there?
Well, I just got here. Why is anything wrong?
No, of course not.
Oh, why do you two look so startled?
Well, your dress.
Yes, it's a startling, beautiful.
And you changed into it so startlingly fast.
And that's it. Startling dress, startling speed.
Darling, perhaps I should go change. I mean, too much excitement isn't good for that ulcer.
Marsha, it's not that startling.
Well, just how startling is it?
Oh, well, now it's looking startled.
What is there about that doorbell? Every time it rings, you lose it like that.
It wasn't the doorbell. It was the mirror.
Oh, I saw my reflection.
Marsha! There you go again, that same look.
Oh, look, darling.
But shouldn't we wait and all go in together?
The last one there is going to get that cold soup, you know.
Well, something to that.
Very well.
Go have a seat. Come on, I'll join you. Just as soon as you've gone.
Don't pay attention.
We'll see you later.
Much later.
Oh, no, sooner than that.
But do hurry.
Oh, well.
Virgil, thank heavens you're here. Did you do it?
Well, I had to rush, but here it is.
And what is that?
It's an imported bottle, or flagon, or whatever you call it, from Switzerland. They make a liqueur there from gentian root. You know gentian, those 6-foot-tall blue flowers that clutter up the Alps.
I thought gentian were yellow flowers and rather tiny.
Ah, that's the American variety. In Switzerland, they're much more remarkable. Anyway, the liqueur that's made for them is, well, it's rather bitter. To be honest, it's positively foul.
Well, then why have you brought it?
I didn't.
Somebody did.
No. Listen. Somebody gave me the liqueur as a present last year for Christmas. But it was so foul, I took one taste and then I poured it out. But the bottle, it was much too lovely to throw away.
But why would you have brought an empty bottle? Oh, you mean...
It wasn't easy. It took me 10 minutes to find a funnel.
Well, so should we bring it to the dining room, or what?
Well, I thought that out here, after dinner, would be more appropriate.
Appropriate? Is there really an appropriate place for murdering one's husband?
Well, when you put it that way, I guess one place is as good as another, but, you know, I'm really rather new at this.
Well, it's hardly habitual with me. I mean, are you sure the poison you put in that bottle is totally tasteless?
Well, they say it is, but how could anyone ever really know? Well, to find out if it was tasteless, you would have to taste it. And once you tasted it, well, you've had it.
I see. I mean, really, a poisoned person is hardly likely to spend his last moments describing flavors.
But I am sure that it's odorless and completely undetectable in a post-mortem.
So, once they've drank it, it hardly matters whether they've enjoyed it now, doesn't it?
What an awful thing to do to your own daughter.
Much, much better.
My favorite.
This almost tastes like straight gin. Might better just put this one in the garbage where it belongs.
Tell me! Who hurt you? Oh, wait a minute, Dave. She has something to do with that hit one page.
She doesn't. Let's go, okay?
Hey, there's something wrong. That suit's getting awful.
What's wrong with that guy?
Marsha, what are you talking about?
You don't know?
Of course not.
But, Toby, you said... I can swear you said you knew what I'd been up to.
I do. But what does that have to do with Bianca?
What in the world is wrong with that Mr. Baxter? He just came back to the dining room table, pale as death, commandeered the wine for half an hour, drinking and sobbing.
I'll go have a talk.
Oh, wait a minute, Marsha. I want an explanation for your conduct. I know what's going on here.
Oh, no. You found out?
You know, too?
Oh, I'm so sorry. What are you and Virgil talking?
What does Virgil have to do with this?
You don't know?
Of course not.
Don't tell him, darling. Now that you know that, you'll do certain men to go through with it. If he doesn't know, won't hurt him.
The hell does. I do know. And I must say, I'm very disillusioned.
Only disillusioned?
Yeah. I thought I could trust you. I thought I knew everything there was to know about your moods, your temperaments. But this was like finding a mousetrap in Disneyland.
What was?
What is all this shouting out here? What in the world is the matter with Virgil?
Well, you see, what is that doing there?
What?
No,
that's Virgil's present. What is that? Virgil got us a gift, and well, he couldn't take the taste, so he just...
No, Marsha, I brought that here tonight for you. That's my gift to you.
What? My own mother? How could you?
Marsha, be quiet. Virgil, I know something about this.
What are you talking about?
What's so clever about it?
confused what's going on here.
Well, you know what, Ben? You need a drink. Well, and you'll join him, of course.
I will.
Well, I mean, he could hardly have a drink and not offer some to a guest.
Darling, there's something I have to tell you about that one.
Oh, Mother, after they drink. After.
Dan, I don't want a drink. I don't feel it.
Not even to wish me a happy birthday?
Oh, that case. But Lynette doesn't have a drink.
Oh, Mother doesn't drink.
She drinks like a fish.
She's giving it up.
Well, she drank her wine at dinner.
No, she had her wine. And quick.
Just like that.
Well, you do need to swear off sometime.
All right then, okay. Happy birthday, darling. A person I can join in.
Well, I hate the other person drinking.
Oh, for heaven's sakes, Aunt.
No! Mother, no!
Fight that terrible urge. You must fight it. Never give it up.
Nonsense! Marsha, I can have a drink if I want one.
Mother, you said you overheard. You said you knew what I was up to. Doesn't that give you a clue?
But there's one thing you don't know.
There's about 10 things. I don't know.
Mother, if you knew what they were up to,
You would have wanted to murder them too.
They were? They are?
If you knew what they had planned for tomorrow morning.
Tomorrow morning?
Down by the bed.
Hold that! You knew?
Of course, Tobias told me all about it last week.
Mother! And me, your own daughter? And not a word of warning?
If I had warned you, it would have spoiled everything. Lord knows you've certainly got it coming to you.
What kind of a mother are you?
Coming to me? Coming to me? I've always been so caring. So loving. So devoted.
Of course you have, darling. That's why he decided to do it.
Mother!
Oh, Marsha, think of it from Tobias' point of view, dear. Year after year, giving you those silly little presents. Meaningless things. Earrings here, perfume there. He knew he had to do something that would just knock you dead. And frankly, I think you deserve it.
Ridiculous.
do you feel?
Getting caught!
fussing, fidgeting, and, well, geez, until your very face starts to look like a neon sign displaying his guilt.
Well, I certainly hope you don't mean me. I don't panic. I'm not the nervous sort. Well, I'm steady as a rock. I have nerves of steel.
You were saying? Hello? Tomorrow? Yes, tomorrow. Oh no, I'm sure that earlier conversation was a mistake. You should go on with the plan. Oh, yes, tomorrow will be fine. Oh, thank you. Well, that was odd.
What? What's odd? What's odd?
The man on the phone. He said that Tobias had ordered a plane, and they were going to deliver it down to the bay tonight, so it would be ready for him tomorrow morning. I wonder why he would do that.
Maybe he was going to use it for his getaway, in case he flubbed your murder.
No, Tobias can't fly.
Maybe he knows somebody who can, does he?
Well, only me. But once he murdered me, I mean, he could hardly expect me to help him.
But of course, if he flubbed your murder, well then...
Oh yes, but I'd hardly be in the mood to help him then either.
Yeah, that's true. Well, why don't you go ahead and tell the man to burn away?
Well, because I figured, if our plan doesn't work out,
the police have planes, and their planes have machine guns.
Well, yes, but the police wouldn't be chasing us in a plane if we started our getaway in a car. Well, because by the time we got to the bay and took off, well, and they got to the bay and saw we took off, and they had to go back and get their planes, and by the time they got their planes and got back to the bay, well, I mean, we'd be off into the blue.
Marsha! Use your head! Where on the bay is the plane going to be?
I don't know.
What make is it? Where would you find the ignition key?
I don't know.
Why is it?
What are you all doing here?
you haven't had time to go to the hospital and find out you weren't going to die.
Well, that's simple enough. By the time we got down the street, Mr. Gilmore had no time to explain what he missed the board really had been, and it certainly made sense.
And when I got there, I realized that what I had tasted was that foul tasting liqueur, and that panicked me so, but I knew it was the poison. It was the poison that was tasteless.
And when Mrs. Thorne assured me that the doctor's bottle had been flushed, I knew that I was safe.
Which brings us back to you, Virgil. What do you mean you didn't try to poison us?
You sound disappointed.
Now listen here, creep. I'm giving you much more leeway than you deserve. We want some answers, we want the right answers fast. In fact, I feel like I should be arresting everybody in sight.
Then, honey, we've been all over that. You can't arrest Mr. Gilmore and Mr. Gore because they weren't planning on murdering Mrs. Gilmore. And you can't arrest Mrs. Gilmore because it was just self-defense on her part.
Well, damn it, all of a sudden we're going to be going out of time here.
Shh, Marshal, hear us.
Okay. So what's this all about? No poison in the bottle.
Yeah. And why did you act so panicky and frantic when you gave us something and you fainted when you knew it wouldn't kill us?
Because I knew it wouldn't kill you. And if you didn't keel over, well, then Marsha would have known I was lying. The whole ghastly truth would have come out.
What ghastly truth?
I'm not a pharmacist. I never have been. Don't even know the least thing about it.
Well, then why did you tell Mr. Gore that you were and let Mrs. Gilmore believe that?
She was so anxious for me to help her. It was the only thing I could think of that might have sounded like I could be of some assistance. Well, I couldn't tell her what I really was.
What really are you?
A kindergarten teacher.
What?
You better explain yourself faster.
Yeah. Come on.
I never had an adventure before. Kindergarten teachers seldom do. Well, I got the idea when Marsha started talking about this Agatha Christie novel that she had read that said that the average home had all these chemicals in it that could be made into a poison that couldn't be detected or smelled, and well, things just got out of hand.
God, all my warnings to Marsha were foolhardy. To think that she, a husband like myself that loves her so much, would try to do her in.
But wait a minute. We eavesdropped on you two. She even had me convinced.
What do you mean?
Well, you were talking about taking her down to the bay, crashing a champagne bottle over her head, and letting her drift off into the ocean. Oh, yeah, and then you two were going to come back here and party.
Oh, but Virgil.
And you were talking about straps to hold her down and nailing something to her seat in her
head. Oh, dear. Tobias, we were. We really were.
Going to murder her?
No, saying those things.
Well, they sure sound like murder.
No, Marsha and Virgil had the wrong nose.
She's talking about the nose of her new birthday present, the seaplane.
Seaplane? Okay, that explains the phone call.
What phone call?
While you two were out, a man called on the phone to say he was delivering a seaplane to the bay, and Marsha told him to go ahead.
Oh, damn. Then she knows about the surprise.
Well, hardly. She thought you two were going to use it for your getaway.
Getaway? From what? We didn't commit a crime.
Well, Marsha didn't know that.
Seems to me the main point is now, what are we going to do?
We're going to teach Marsha a lesson she'll never forget. If she wasn't reading this mind-rotting junk like the creepy slasher, none of this would have happened.
Tobias.
Say, you know, I think you're right. She said the book was about a husband who was planning to knock off his wife.
It's a shame that I must have read it. You could have used this plot to really give her a scare.
Tobias.
It's a pity none of us has a requisite rotted mind. Only some kind of a moron research trash.
Tobias.
Yeah, what?
I've read it.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's the first thing she told me when she came in here this morning.
Oh, my, Persis, I apologize. How will I ever?
Oh, sir, you might not have to apologize to her. Perhaps her mind is about it, too.
Bianca!
Shh! Look, the point is, I have read it, and I think I know how we can use it to teach Marsha that lesson. It's about time she learned the difference between fact and fiction.
Amen to that.
So, what's your plan?
Well, in the book, the woman's begun to suspect her husband.
Just like Marsha!
She's tried calling the police, but they think she's a wacko and won't come.
Just like Marsha!
Now, the woman is having a torrid love affair with another man.
I didn't say anything.
So, the husband forces the lover to telephone her, so that when she comes to the phone, the husband can come creeping out of the kitchen behind her with the huge butcher knife he's used for all his other killings.
That's great. Do it. But what if she struggles?
She can't. The husband's girlfriend ties her up.
This is exciting. What happens next?
Well, a long time ago, when the heroine was a little girl, her grandfather told her if she was ever in trouble...
Marsha, enough information.
Oh, no, what did the grandfather tell her?
All right. Now, let's do it.
But wait a minute. Marsha doesn't have a lover. You be her lover. Me? Why me?
Well, you were almost her lover already today.
But I can't.
Yes, you can.
But what am I going to say to her on the phone when I call her?
Into your head.
Well, I can't think of anything. All I can think of is what nice weather we're having.
In the book. He can read the conversation right out of that.
That's great. Just read it and do it.
Well, I guess that sounds easy enough.
All right, is everything set to go?
Now, wait a minute. I just don't think this type of thing is legal.
Ben.
Yes, ma'am?
Hi. Do you ever hope to date me again?
Well, of course.
I mean, guess what? It's legal.
All right, Virgil, you go to your apartment. You ring here in about a moment. That'll get her out of the bedroom. I'll go in the kitchen, and I'll get the butcher knife, and I'll be around the arch for you.
And where will the rest of us go?
I don't know, out in the hall, I suppose.
Not in your life. I don't want to miss any of this.
Well, neither do I.
I can't stay here.
Well, really high. Besides, I feel like I should be in the premises anyhow. Just in case you get caught up in your rolls and slash your...
Oh, come on.
Oh, Tobias, be a sport.
All right, everybody hide. Virgil, you come back to your apartment. And I'll go and get the butcher knife.
Her husband is... Ah! No, this doesn't happen! Well, this doesn't happen!
She makes my seventh victim.
Seven? Toby, what does this mean?
It means so that police can't detect. They won't catch on to my tenth victim.
One murder, one stab. Two murders, two stabs. And the police still haven't decided there's a connection between them all. Why do the police always have to be so infernally stupid?
Enough chit-chat. Come on, I'm prepared to die.
By the way, Slasher?
Yes?
When you do stab her seven times?
Yes.
Try to make it look like an accident.
That's gross.
But, Toby, all of Anton Dupre's books are very silly.
They are?
Well, of course they are. Why do you think I read them?
Why do you...
But, Toby, use your brain. I mean, would anyone ever write a serious mystery novel? Ever call it anything like The Creeping Slasher? And would anyone ever end a serious novel like the finale of The Creeping Slasher, where the heroine decides to... No! I haven't finished it yet.
And you won't finish it, like I told you!
No, wait! Toby, please, before you kill me, let me do the one thing my grandfather always said to do in times of peril.
What, Grandpa?
In the book!
Oh, that time! What did your grandfather tell you to do in times of peril?
Now I lay me down.
Well, silly or not, prepare to die.
No, that's not what the Slasher says.
What did she say?
Soon, your radiant beauty will be lying here in seven pieces.
Of course, that's silly.
Well, she told you the books were silly. Well, wait, Toby, if you must kill me, will you honor me one final request?
No. What request?
Will you take the Creeping Slasher back to the library?
What?
Well, it's already 2 days overdue!
All right, I'll take it back when I kill you.
Well, could you take it back first and then come back and kill me?
No, you might escape.
Well, that would be the general idea.
Prepare to die.
No, say it. Soon your radiant beauty will be lying here in seven pieces.
But that's
what... What do you mean?
Well, picture Marsha's a loaf of bread, right? You cut one piece. One time I slice it, you get two pieces, right? If I do the second one twice, it's three pieces. Now, if I do the third one...
Wait, not so fast.
Why, what's the matter?
Well, I'm still trying to picture Marsha as a loaf of bread.
Marsha's?
I told you the books were silly.
Silly or not, prepare to die.
Now, will you make your final threat? As I indicated?
Soon, your body will be lying here in seven radiant pieces! Take your clothes off! Last
go! Don't wait!
Get goosebumps!
No, don't wait! I'll get it! I'll get it!
Freeze!
Why would I want to poison Toby? I love him!
Yes, but how did you know that Mr.
Baxter wasn't a pharmacist.
Oh, well, I've seen him go off to work in the morning.
And?
Well, I ask you, would a pharmacist ever carry a Sesame Street lunchbox?
Well, I'm confused. I thought you thought a pharmacist and I were trying to murder you or something.
I did it first. I mean, I must admit, but well, then when Persis came into the room after she had taken her coat off and fluffed up her hair, I knew it couldn't be true.
What?
Well, darling, look at her. That woman is just not your type.
Oh, yeah? Just what sort of woman is my type?
Well, my type, of course.
She's got me there.
Oh, I just love a happy ending.
Does it have a happy ending?
Marsha, you don't expect to finish that book.
Well, of course I do, and well, don't you want to read it too?
Damn it, I do.
Marsha, bring the book along to the dining room table. You can read it aloud as we finish eating.
Well, that reminds me, Ben, I'm starving. What's the way to eat
up? But wait a minute. Why don't you two stay? We've got plenty to go around.
Well, if you think it'd be okay.
We'll get to hear how the book ends.
Oh, that's lovely. Let's go.
Cool. If I have to read the book during dinner, I don't have time to eat.
Well, you know, cold soup makes you nauseous, remember?
Oh. By the way, Virgil, where did you get that gun?
Well, it wasn't mine. I confiscated it from one of my pupils.
Your kindergarten pupils have guns?
Hasn't been easy.
Well, I'll eat fast and then get back to do the upholstery next evening.
Horses, after all you've been through tonight, I intend to double your fee.
Tobias, considering the events of this evening, I intend to triple it.
Shelter?
Oh, yes, I am famished.
Oh, wait a minute, that bugs. Hello? Yeah, this is it. Police? My wife said what? No, I love my wife very much, and I don't intend to murder her tonight or any night. No, it will not cross my heart and hope to die. Gosh. Well, happy birthday, darling.
And many happy returns.
Oh, God, I'm kidding.
What's up?
Nice job, Jeff.
What's up?